You'll be able to hear myself a little bit. Everyone doing well?
Yeah.
Good. I'm glad. I'm glad that you all chose to come to God's house and worship Him. I believe that music can change the atmosphere in a place, and I think that last song that we sang really clears the atmosphere for receiving from God. I don't know about you, but I prepared for this moment, but I still expect to receive something from Him, and I want to be part of seeing you receive something from Him. I want to do this. If you have a desire to really receive and you'd like to, I love note takers, man. I'll tell you, I think Jesus loves note takers. And if you want to learn and grow and jot some things down, I want to be a part of that. I want to help you with that. Does anyone else need a notebook? It's great to take some notes and jot down scripture references. You want to make sure that you, once you get to the pasture and this green grass, then you take what you got and you graze on it all week, right? So yeah, there we go. That's what I'm talking about. Just waiting for my soldier to raise his hand right there. And Mrs. Soldier too, yes. Thank you. Everybody, I got one left. Anybody? Anyone? No? Well, feel free to come grab it anytime you want. I'm very, very thankful that you've gathered here. I'm thankful that you give me someone to talk to. This would be uncomfortable if there was nobody out there. And so I'm very thankful for that. If I could just have you grab a copy of God's Word. You said you want heaven to open up so you can hear something, right? Well, it's wide open right here, okay? So get a copy of God's Word and turn to the Gospel of Luke, and we're gonna pursue some truth. Why are we grabbing a Bible anyway? Like, what are we doing here? Why are we gathered in church? Why are we gathered around this book and looking at these words in this book? Like, what's the reason why we do this? Is it because it's the weekend and you guys are rebellious and you don't want to do it on Sunday? I don't know, maybe that's what it is. Could be a lot of different reasons why we're grabbing a book, but we're grabbing a book because we want to learn, we want to grow. Something should happen here, right? There should be something accomplished. You know the guy, and you've heard of him, his name is Peter, right? Big guy in the Bible, big guy in the early church. You know, he wrote two books in the scriptures, real creative names, 1st and 2nd Peter. And in 2nd Peter chapter 1, two verses talk about growing in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, that's good, right? We want to grow, right? Do we? Yeah. Why? So that's the question again. Why do we want to grow in our knowledge? Why do we want to get to know who this Jesus Christ is, what He taught, what He said, who He was, what He's doing, what He will do? Why do we want to know this? So we could, because knowledge puffs up, makes us arrogant sometimes. Anyone know any know-it-alls? Obnoxious, right? Nobody likes that. Nobody likes a know-it-all. So what's the reason why we're gaining knowledge? Well, not only does the Bible tell us what we should do, but it tells us why. And if you read those verses, it'll tell us that we want to grow in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ to be more productive and to be more useful. See, I don't know about you, but my desire, I have a lot of desires in my life, right? But one of the greatest desires of my life is that not only myself, but the church that I'm part of would make a real difference in this world. That this world would be forever changed because we existed. I need reason to get up in the morning, amen, right? More than just going to make a paycheck. I've done it. And it's good to make a paycheck. If you're making a paycheck, that's good. You should do that because it's not fun to not eat. But there needs to be more to your life. There's a reason why you exist. He wants us to be useful and productive for His kingdom. We need to know who Jesus Christ is. It's an ongoing theme in the Bible about growing in Him and knowing more about Him. You know, in John chapter 4, He meets this woman who's a Samaritan, and she worshiped God, and her people worshiped God. But He looked at her, and He said sort of a derogatory statement. He said, "You worship a God that you don't even know. You know, you've heard of Him. You know there's a God. You know you've heard a little bit about Him, but you don't even know who He is." Why would Jesus say that? Lest He wanted us to know who He was, right? And then He goes on to open up and tell her who He is, right? He wants us to know. So when Jesus says to worship him in spirit and in truth, I don't know about you, but I take that like very, very seriously. And I believe here at Revolution Church, we take this thing really, really seriously. So it's like full tilt boogie, like kick the tires, light the fires, let's get after this thing. I want to know the truth, right? I want to know the truth. And so that's what we've been doing. I want to know the truth about who Jesus is so we can worship him well. So we can worship him correctly. So we can worship him, here's a new one, productively. I want something to come out of what we're doing here. If nothing happens as a result of us gathering, why are we here? Why do we have our Bibles open? Why is that thing highlighted unless something's going to come out of it, right? Don't just study it. Something has to happen. I want something to come of this thing called Revolution Church. I want some, the Bible would say, fruit. You know, Jesus talks about that a lot. He talks about the investing in someone, how God invests in someone. And when he invests in someone, what does he want? He wants a return. He wants something to happen. He wants there to be some fruit at the end of the vine, some results. Everyone, including Jesus, is very task-oriented. He's results-driven. His word says that his desire is that all are saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. He's results-driven. Don't make a mistake about it, about who he is. So we're going to ask a question. The question I've asked before. We talked about it a couple weeks ago. As a matter of fact, we talked about it a lot of times during this journey through the Gospel of Luke. And as a matter of fact, you just heard it again on the video for like the 27th time as we've been venturing through this gospel together. And the question is this, who do you say that I am? I'm just going to tell you that it's the only question that matters. I don't know what you guys are doing after church tonight, but I got news for you. It doesn't matter. I don't know what you guys are doing tomorrow. It doesn't matter. That's all that matters is who do you say Jesus Christ is? That's all that matters. All the rest of the stuff is going to fall by the wayside come glory time. So we need to make a decision on who he is. Now don't say, well, this is redundant because some of you may not have been here those other weeks. And don't say it's redundant because if the Bible asks it often, then it's important. And so therefore it's important for me to tell you, and it's important for you to take some notes and learn and grow and understand. So I asked you to go to Luke, right? So go to specifically Luke chapter 9. I'm going to start answering this question, not based on what I think or what you think or what your mama thinks, but what the Bible says, the truth. Luke chapter 9, you see this question kind of unfold in verse 7. We'll start right there. It won't be the only place we visit, for sure. You're going to get gorged tonight. Does God have everyone's attention? All right. You got your phones away? Okay, so here's when Herod Antipas, the puppet ruler, let's just call him that, worthless and powerless guy who was a ruler over the Jewish folks that lived around the Sea of Galilee, he had, let me show you how much power he had. This much. He was a puppet under the authority of Rome. Rome had the power. This guy really has nothing, but he's there. And when Herod Antipas, the ruler of Galilee, heard about everything Jesus was doing, he was doing a lot of stuff, right? He's going around village to village. He's preaching the word. He's performing miracles, casting out demons. People are getting raised from the dead. Sicknesses are going bye-bye. He's doing all this kind of stuff, right? And this guy hears about it, and look what it says. He was puzzled. I think that's pretty common now, right? I bet you there's some people in this room right now that are a little bit puzzled. Who is this Jesus anyway? Who does he think he is? Well, this guy was puzzled, and he wanted to know, and I think that's probably why you're here tonight. Well, some were saying that John the Baptist had been raised from the dead. Others thought Jesus was Elijah, one of the other prophets, risen from the dead. And Herod goes, wait a minute, I beheaded John the Baptist he's talking about. So if he's headless, who is this man about whom I hear such stories? And he kept trying to see him. So he's he's like, wait, I cut this guy's head off, but maybe it's him. And he's confused. And there's no truth here. Like, we're not told who Jesus is in this section. But from this section, can't you see that even the people then, they knew there was something like super special about him. He wasn't just a powerful leader or a great speaker. There was something special about this Jesus. Like, he wasn't just a guy that had some authority. They were thinking he was a guy that was raised from the dead. So no matter who he is, he's very special, right? And so we can see that they held him in high regard. They knew there was something amazing about this guy, but they couldn't really figure out who he was. He was not the only one who was puzzled. In our culture today, people are puzzled about who Jesus is. He's on covers of magazines all the time. And everyone has their view and their perspective about who Jesus is and what he did. People are puzzled. People are curious. If you jump over to verse 18 of the same chapter, the attention turns from this Herod Antipas, who's puzzled about who Jesus is, thinking he's got to be someone amazing. He was raised from the dead. I don't know if he's John the Baptist or Elijah or one of these other amazing prophets of old, but he's someone special. And so one day Jesus looks even at his own followers, which you are. If you've bent the knee to Jesus and he's your Lord, then you're one of his disciples. But that didn't stop Jesus from really getting in their grill and asking them something right to the point. And so he asks the same thing to you right here. One day Jesus left the crowds to pray alone. Only his disciples were with him. And he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" Well, we kind of know that. We heard that just a moment ago, but they repeat it. Well, they replied, "Some say John the Baptist. Some say Elijah." Now, notice something before I go on. Do you see what it said, "they replied"? So he's talking to a group of men, 12 guys, right? But so it doesn't tell us in the text exactly who replied. So it's kind of like a group effort. They're kind of just, you ever have, you break up in groups and then you appoint a leader and they'll speak for you, right? So they had a leader in Peter, but they're kind of just voicing up. You know, hey, this and this and this. And so they start yelling out the same answers we heard a moment ago. Some say John the Baptist. You see the other guy over here, maybe. Well, some say Elijah. And the other over here says, the others say, we don't know which ones, you're one of the other ancient prophets risen from the dead. So they're not saying who he is. They just think he's someone special. They've seen what he's done. They know he's an amazing person, so much so that he must have raised from the dead. But not quite what he deserves, right? And so Jesus, not being satisfied with that answer because they have yet to answer it correctly, he stops and he says, who do you say that I am? I don't care what everyone else says out there in the crowd. I want to know you guys, my disciples, I want to know who you say I am. And Peter, the leader, he steps forth and he replies. He says, "You are the Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One, sent from God." You know, Matthew tells this same story. Matthew has this tendency to go a little bit more in detail of the same story. I just want you to go there. "Who do you say that I am, Peter? Who do you say that I am?" Matthew chapter 16, verse 15. Same question there. "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter answers him, "You are the Messiah," which is the Christ, which is the Anointed One. All the same meaning. "The Son of the Living God." So he expands a little bit. You know what the Anointed One is? The Anointed One, this Greek word is krio. And it's this. This is the definition of anointed one. It gets thrown around church, this anointed word. Anointed, anointed. You have the anointing. You're anointed. Anoint this. Anoint that. What does anointed one mean? What does anointed mean? It means to consecrate to an office or particular service. Specific. Consecrated. That means holy, not like H-O-L-Y, but holy. W-H-O-L-L. Why? Completely set apart for this thing. That's who you are. And that's who God is. And that's who Jesus Christ is. He's the anointed one consecrated for this purpose. Something special about him. He's not just a guy raised from the dead. This same word anointed is used in Luke 4:18 where it says, Jesus was anointed to bring the good news to the poor. Also in Acts 10:38, Peter says, Jesus was anointed with the Holy Spirit and power. 2 Corinthians 1:21, this word is used yet again. Creo. God has creoed us, anointed us. Not Jesus now, he's talking about us. Right? Anointed us by placing the Holy Spirit in us. That's awesome, right? That's awesome. And also, Jesus is clearly identified by God the Father himself, the unseen one, when in Luke 9, chapter 9, verse 35, there's a voice that comes out from the cloud, and this unseen Father of all time, this voice comes from the cloud and says, this is my dearly beloved son, my chosen one. Listen to him. Listen, touch your neighbor. Touch your neighbor and look at him and say, that should be enough. That should be enough. Right? That's all we need. We don't need any further clarification about who Jesus Christ is. When a voice comes out of a cloud and says, that's my son, follow him, you should listen. You don't need any more explanation. But the Bible doesn't leave us there because we're stubborn and rebellious children. So we look back at the Matthew account that we were just in, and we see that God's word further solidifies the identity of Jesus Christ. Look at verse 15 through 18. Who are you? Peter says, you're the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replies, you are blessed, Peter, because my Father in heaven, this unseen one, the one who speaks from a cloud, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You didn't learn this from any human being. Now I say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. And all the power, this is a good place for an amen. You guys ready for it? Yes. I will build my church and all the powers of hell will not conquer it.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, so we're the church. He said, I'm going to build my church and hell's not going to prevail. And hell's not going to stop this thing called my church. And that's who we are. And that's what we do. And all of this that we do here together as a family, it has a foundation. It has a power. It has a source. It's a rock that it's built on. And some would say from this text that Peter is the rock. And Peter, he was an early leader of the church, and he was an amazing man. And some would even stretch that a little bit further and say he was the first pope. But a careful study of the exact wording of God's perfect, say perfect, his perfect word teaches us otherwise. Peter, he says, and you are Peter. That's Petros. First Timothy 3:16 says, every word of God is God-breathed. Every word in your Bible is valuable, and it comes right from God's mouth. And so we can't rush by it. Peter is Petros. It means rock. But if you look at the definition, it means a piece of rock. See that? It's a piece of rock. It's a rock you could put in your hand. It's a rock that you could skim across a lake. Right? It's a piece of rock. But he goes on to say, but upon this rock I will build my church. And every word is important. Every word is coming right out of the mouth of God, right? Not from the pen of men, from the heart of God. Peter, Petros, but upon this rock, what's this rock? Petra. It's important. Don't just blow through and go, well, the guy's name is Peter. It means rock. That means he's building this church on it. No, no, no. It's Petra. It's not a piece of rock. It's a mass of rock. It's that. It's something you can stand on. It's something that you can put your weight on. It's something you can build on. It's something you can count on. It's solid. You can't skip that sucker across the lake, could you? You can't. It's a Petra. It's this same word Petra is used in 1 Corinthians 10:4. And Paul, speaking to this church, he's referring back to the history of God's people, and he's telling them about Moses and the Israelites and how they got out of Egypt, and they're going across the desert to the promised land. And if you remember the story, they were hungry, so God fed them manna from heaven, and they were hungry again. And so he fed them quail, blew in, and they all came down and died right there so they could eat them. Birds, right? Crazy. And then they were thirsty, so he gave them water out of a rock. Awesome stuff, right? And so in 1 Corinthians 10:4, he's talking about this, and he said that these people ate from the spiritual food and they drank from the spiritual rock, Petra, who was Jesus. That's what it says. That's who they drank from. It says it again in 1 Peter chapter 2. You can go there if you want. I'm going there. So you might as well go, otherwise you'll be waiting for me. 1 Peter chapter 2. 6-8. You there? Who would miss this? Who would not come to church? You got to be out of your mind, right? Crazy people. They what? Okay. So 1 Peter chapter 2, 6-8. Talking about Petra, look at what it says here. The scriptures say, this is God. I am placing a cornerstone in Jerusalem. That's not it. Sounds like it might be, but it's not. I'm placing a cornerstone in Jerusalem, chosen for great honor, and anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. Yes, you who trust him recognize the honor God has given him, but for those who reject him, the stone, that's not it, that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. That's good, but that's not it. And he is the stone, that's not it either, that makes people stumble, the Petra that makes them fall. Jesus Christ is the rock of the church. Okay? Not any man. Jesus is. And you need to understand this. He's the Messiah. He's the Christ, the chosen one, the anointed one, the Son of the living God, the rock of the church. That's Jesus Christ the Lord. And so our brother Paul the Apostle, he outlines with clarity who this Jesus is. Like, why does Jesus have such lofty titles? Why is he the Messiah? Why is he the Christ, the anointed one of the Son of the living? Like, who is this guy anyway? And so Paul outlines his Jesus' resume for us so we could see why. Why such lofty titles, right? Do me a favor, go to my favorite section of Scripture, Colossians chapter 1. Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, all written by the Apostle Paul under the inspiration of God's Holy Spirit, carefully choosing his words so we could understand. I love Luke says, I'm putting down a careful outline here for you, a careful account so you can know the truth. That's what God's word is. We need to know, right? Anyone want to know? I want to know. I don't want to worship some phony God. I got no time for that. Okay, so here's six things that I got for you. And I want you to jot them down, please. Six things. The resume of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one. Here's the first thing. He has seniority. Look at verse 15, the second line there. We'll get to the first in a minute. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. Look also in verse 17. I guess he's trying to make a point. He existed before anything else. He existed before anything, before stars and planets, before time and heat, before gravity and water. There was God, and there was Jesus, unexplainably present, but nevertheless, there he was. And don't ask me about that, because I can't explain it. He was with God, and he was God at the same time. Seniority here is a little bit different than in the heavens. See, seniority here in this world, what does that get you? Might get you to decide what radio station you get to put on in the car. Maybe it might get you the remote at home. Might get you the best seat in the house, right? Let me tell you something. When my little Jackson, who's 3 years old, comes up to me and tells me what we're watching for a movie, that doesn't go good for him. You know why? Because I have seniority. He doesn't. I've been here longer. So I get to say about, you know, most stuff I get to decide. He doesn't. He's three. So in verse 15, when it goes on to say that he's supreme over all creation, that just means that God, you know, Jesus Christ, he gets to decide what's going to happen around here. Well, you might say, well, I don't like this whole God thing. I've heard people say this. I don't like this God thing because, you know, who is he to make a hell that's the lake of fire and burning sulfur and send people there? And I don't like that. Tough. Well, I don't like Florida. It's too hot here. Move. It's his dirt and it's his sun. And if he wants it to roast, get out and halfback it. That was not an encouragement to move. Don't take scripture out of context. He existed before anything. So it's his Florida. And it's his heaven. And he decides how you get in. He decides where lightning goes. He decides where rain falls. He decides everything. And if you don't like it, tough. I don't know what else to say. I could hug you and tell you tough and make you feel better, but I don't want to hug you. It's tough. It's just the way it is. You know, he existed before anything also means that this whole Jehovah's Witness thing about him being the first creation, out the window, dude. Okay, if he existed before anything was created, is he not anything? So, you right? I mean, I'm not even that smart. I'm really not. But if he existed before anything was created, he's not created. First thing is he's got seniority. Here's the second thing. He's the creator. He's the creator. Look at verse 16. For through who? Who is Paul talking about here? Well, the sentence started out in 15, Christ. So he's talking about Christ. Jesus. Jesus. You there with me? For through Jesus, God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one God, three persons, don't understand it, that's just what it is. Otherwise tough, right? For through Jesus, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. And then my favorite part of the whole Bible. This is it. One sentence. It's all for me. Everything was created through Him and for Him. Listen, you just got the answer to the reason why you live. It's not to go hang drywall, is it, Andy? It's not even to paint it when you're done. You're there for Him. That's it. That's the reason why you're alive. It's for Him. So when Psalm 33 says that the Lord merely spoke and the heavens were created and that He breathed the word and all the stars were born, that He, that Lord, that was Jesus Christ. John said God created everything through Jesus Christ. What's this mean for you and me? High and lofty stuff, but what's it mean for us? Well, aren't you supposed to honor your mother and father? Right? You're supposed to. Not all of us are very successful at that all the time, but we know in our heart we're supposed to. But really, the mom and dad are only symbolic for the reality that God is our Father. And He deserves honor, respect, and here's the last one, you don't want to hear it, obedience. Obedience. How do you honor your mother and father? Scripture talks about it. I think it's in Ephesians chapter 6. It doesn't even say honor anymore. Because Paul has a way in the New Testament of upping it a little bit. I think Jesus gave him a little bit of a nudge. It's not even honor. What is it? Obey! Obey. He said, obey your mother and father. And so, since God is our heavenly Father, we should honor Him by obeying Him. And much like seniority carries power, well, Creator carries with it power, but power that's even a bit stronger. Because it's not I've been here the longest, it's I own it. It's mine. It's mine. I own it. Psalm 24:1. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all its people belong to Him. Right? Kind of puts you in your place a little bit, doesn't it? A little humbling. Do you want me to read it again? Because it probably doesn't feel so good. Here, let me give you another one. Genesis 14:22. In the King James and New American Standard, it says that the Lord, God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. Right here. He has it in His hands, in His pockets. It's mine. Jesus Christ, possessor, owner, creator of everything. And He loves you. You know what? If He was the owner and He couldn't stand you, that would suck. But He loves you. He died for you. God made a way for you. He provides for you. Did anyone live today? Are you alive? Because I don't know, when I heard this music, I didn't sense that you were even alive. I'm just being honest. I didn't sense the celebration. I didn't feel the heart in your chest pounding because you're so excited about Jesus Christ. I didn't feel it. But I kind of see that you're living, so I know that you're alive. You know why? Because God loves you and He lets you live a day. You have a reason to celebrate. You have a reason to celebrate. He possesses all of heaven and earth. And you know what? The quicker you realize that, the quicker you realize that He is holy and above, the quicker you realize that He owns everything and you don't, what is it that you have that He has not given? Even the hardest working man. I think probably the hardest working man in the room. All respect to all of you. He's a freak. But I know my brother Jared, and I know that he knows that there's nothing he has that God has not given him. What is it that we have that we have not been given? So therefore, why would we boast about anything that we have as if it was not given? God owns everything, and so everything you have is a gift from Him. And the sooner you realize this, the sooner you get to live in freedom. That's what you were designed to do. He has seniority. He's creator. Here's the third thing. You'll see it right there in the text. Look at verse 17. He existed before anything else, and He holds all creation together. So He has seniority, He's creator, and He's the sustainer. Do you know that inside our bodies, it's kind of interesting, some of you may know this, inside of our bodies we have these, It goes down, 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 down. We have muscles and bones and this and that. We have cells, and we have inside of ourselves, we have in the middle, there's atoms, and then there's in the middle of the atom, there's protons, and they're at the center in the nucleus, and there's these proton charges, and then there's neutrons, and there's electrons. So there's neutrons and protons in the middle, and they're flying around. You can't really see them because they're really small. There's these electrons. They're negatively charged, and they're going around the outside and stuff. And so in the middle of this, what's your name? What is it? Can you come here a second? I don't want you to regret coming to Florida, but I want you to stand here for a second. You're part of the message now, okay? What was your name again?
Michelle.
Michelle Mabel. Yes. No. Well, I wouldn't say that because I learned that you played hockey today. You might punch me. So I'm not going to sing songs like love songs to you at all.
No, that wouldn't go there.
Ever.
No.
Ever. Okay. So inside Michelle's body, did you guys know, like, I'm not a scientist, but inside of him are what scientists would say, I don't know if there's any truth to it because they're scientists, but that there's like 40 trillion cells inside this human body. 40 trillion. It's a lot, right? So think about this. Inside these 40 billion, trillion cells are these protons and electrons, right? And in the middle of all these atoms, all of his body, is these protons. And you know, there's this law in physics called Coulomb's Law. And Coulomb's Law says that the fact, the truth is that like charges repel each other. Do you ever hold a magnet together, the like sides, and it just, what does it do? You can't put them together. Why? It throws them apart, right? That's what's inside of your body by the trillions of them inside of him. So what should happen? He doesn't have 40 trillion cells. He has 40 trillion nuke bombs inside of him, and he should be exploding. But guess what? He's not. He's here, and he's living, right? He's alive. And he's living, and he's moving, and he's breathing, I think. Mm-hmm. Right? And the Bible would say in Acts 17:28, for in him, Christ, we live and move and breathe. God, thank you. Thank you. Right? See, the science would say something different. Science won't say that in him all things are sustained and held together. Science wouldn't say in him we live and move and breathe because we're in him. Right? He's holding us together. No, it doesn't say that. See, science says, Coulomb's Law says that like charges repel. Why isn't he exploding? Because these same foolish scientists have this other thing that goes, I don't understand how he's held together. So there's this other law of physics called the strong force. And the strong force is what holds all these particles together in the atomic nucleus. And when you look it up in the dictionary, this is what it says. It's amazing. As the name implies, this is the strongest force known to nature. They won't call it what it is. Jesus Christ is holding us together. That's the truth. How can light particles explode and hold together at the same time? This is how lost people are. When me all the while, it's Jesus Christ holding us together. That's crazy. Jesus Christ, the creator and the possessor of all creation, is holding us together. Here's the fourth thing, seniority, creator, sustainer. Verse 18, look at there. Not making anything up, it's just right here in the text. Christ is also the head of the church, which is his body. That means he's your pastor. Okay? You might think I'm the pastor. I'm not the pastor. I'm the under-pastor at best. I'm not the guy. Jesus is the guy. He's your pastor, okay? Jeremiah 3:15 says of God, I will give you shepherds after my own heart who will guide you with knowledge and understanding. Okay? So he gave me to you to help with this task of shepherding you, but I'm not your pastor. I'm the associate pastor. Jesus Christ is your pastor. John 10:14 says, I am the good shepherd. I know, listen, he was a possessor, right? I know my sheep, and they hear my voice, and they follow me. He owns you. You've been bought with a price. I didn't buy you. I own nothing. If I even walk out of this joint with a pen, I'm lucky. I own nothing. People say, oh, it kind of rubs me. I don't know what they're saying. You know, oh, can I, you know, I want to come to your church, or this is your, like makes me cringe. I hate, like, I understand what they mean, you know, the one that you attend, the one that you work at, the one that you live life with. But they say yours, it implies ownership, and it makes my skin crawl. You know what I mean? I'm lucky he's just understanding of me so that if I say yes, he doesn't strike me dead. You know what I mean? Like, I don't even want that. You know, I don't own anything. It's his church. He's the possessor of all things. He's an amazing, do you know Romans 8:34 states that Jesus is currently sitting at the place of honor at God's right hand pleading for you right now. What are you doing? You're sitting here. That's awesome. I'm here. I'm like yelling and stuff. But he, you know what he's doing? He's pleading to the Father. Yeah, I know Felicia, she messed up today, but just she's with me. She's with me. Is that cool? All right, son, you can let her in again. That's he's pleading for you right now. He's an awesome pastor. He's always praying for you. I'm like hardly ever praying for you. I'm just being honest, right? I'm busy doing stuff. How many people spend their whole day praying for me? Like no one. Except Jesus. He's praying for me all the time. That's awesome, right? Andy, I think you pray for me a lot, and I appreciate that. But you're not Jesus. You took a break on me, dude. He never does. He's an amazing pastor. Seniority, creator, sustainer, pastor. Here's the last two. They'll come at you quick. He's our Savior. Verse 20. And through him, who is Paul talking about? Yeah, Yeshua, Jesus, the Christ, the Anointed One, the Messiah. And through Jesus, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything. I think that includes you. In heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. See, there's something that we can't, there's a lot of influence we can have on things in our world, but there's one thing I know we can't influence at all because it happened a long time ago. This stubborn Adam and Eve, they committed sin, and as a result of that, you are a passive recipient of this sin that they did. Did you ever get in trouble when you're in school? Because someone in your class did something wrong, you all had to do push-ups? Or someone did something wrong and no one gets to go to recess. Oh, I hate that. That's Adam. And when you get to heaven, you can't do it though. Sorry. I just, you know, God gave you just a momentary lapse of hatred and sin. Enjoy it because it's never going to happen there. Because you're going to like them there for some reason. I don't even get that. But you're going to like them there. You're going to forgive them there. Crazy. But true. So Adam sins, and so this sin nature is passed on to you at the molecular level. Speaking of atoms and protons, right? So at the molecular level, it's like it's just in who you are, but yet that's not even good enough. You want to be worse. So not only are you a passive recipient of the sin nature, but you're an active rebellion against God by committing sin on your own. Adam didn't even need to tell you to be rotten. You did it on your own. The Bible tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Romans chapter 3 tells us, this is a stinger, that the entire world is guilty before God. Ouch. All of us sin and fall short. But look back at Colossians. Verse 21. You there? I was just giving you this universal indictment, right? Well, I don't know. I don't know if that was me. Well, this includes you. Who were once far away from God. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. So it paints this picture that God's over here somewhere, and he's perfect and holy and awesome, and you're over here, and you got the sin nature of Adam in you, and you're also an act of rebellion, and you're doing stuff wrong. And so what happened is there's a separation right here. Here's the problem of humankind, right here. This rug, here's the problem. It's also a problem because it keeps tripping me. Someone could fix that. But there's a problem there. But, by means of Christ's blood, you are saved. And the amazing thing, and a lot of people don't understand this, and they get caught up in all these rules and regulations of churches. I was online today, and I'm not mentioning names, but I saw someone say that this church gave her a bunch of rules, and she couldn't live by it, so they asked her not to come back. And I don't know the circumstances. Maybe it was justified, maybe it was not, but I just know that there's a lot of that. And I know there's a lot of steps given to get to be a Christian and be forgiven, and you got to do this and you got to do that and all that stuff. And I don't know if anyone's ever told you the truth, but this truth of ours is found in, and everyone, all churches will tell you this if they're real churches of Christ, that this is the truth standard. And this truth standard basically, in a nutshell, just tells us that if you believe that Jesus Christ is the perfect Son of God and He went to the cross and died for your sin, and you just believe that, then you can receive that reconciliation right then and there. That's it. You just got the gospel. That's it. You're not that good, and He's awesome, and He paid for you. And if you just say yes, you can be in for sure. So I want to ask the band to come up as we do that. I'm going to give you the last thing. Six things I told you. Gave you five. He has seniority. He's creator. He's sustainer. He's pastor. And He's savior. Here's the last thing. But I would venture to say that the last thing's the most important thing. The last thing is found in verse 15. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. Verse 19, for God in, can someone read that next word for me? For God in all His fullness was pleased to live in Christ. There's no divine power loss, nothing diminished in the deity of Jesus Christ while He was here in the flesh. As a matter of fact, chapter 2, verse 9, Paul says, for in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. Now remember I told you that every word's important? Listen, Paul wrote this after Jesus Christ went to the cross and died. And he used the present tense. I'm going to read it again. For in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. John 1:14 says, Jesus Christ put on flesh, came down, and dwelt among us. In the beginning, before space and time, before anything was, there was God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And this Christ, this Creator, this Sustainer, this Pastor, this Savior, this God, this Messiah, this Anointed One, and the Rock, this is who He is. This is Jesus Christ. And so the question I have for you as we come to a close of the message, if Jesus Christ is Creator and Sustainer and Pastor and Savior and God and Messiah, the Anointed, well, let me ask you this. Is He those things to you? Because that's all that really matters. It doesn't even matter if your husband thinks that or your wife thinks it. Doesn't matter. It's all that matters is what you think. Is He those things to you? It's the most important question you can ever ask or answer. He said that He's building His church. And so the question that I have for you is, are you part of that? Are you part of His unstoppable force, this family that He created? Are you part of His church? Are you part of His family? Are you part of the bride? Are you part of the family of faith that will rule and reign forever with Christ as King. See, I'm not this guy who's going to like put fear into you. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, all that kind of stuff. That doesn't work. That's cheesy. You come to Christ that way, just stay in your seat. The question is, as an act of your will, you've heard the truth of what God's Word says about who He is. And so I just want to ask you right now, is Jesus Christ the Lord of your life? Is He the Messiah to you? Is He the Christ to you? Is He God to you? Is He your pastor? Is He your Savior? That's all you got to do is believe and receive it. And we'll go from there. We'll grow from there. But you just got to say yes. It's scandalous, but it's true. It's that simple. You just got to say yes. I want you to bow with me real quick. Bow in prayer. Bow your heads. Close your eyes. Not just because I don't want you to look at me, but just as a posture. Because if He is God, if He is Savior, if He is the Anointed One, then we should worship Him. We should bow before Him. Right? We should bow. Lord, I thank You for the clarity of Your Word. I thank You that You're so kind that you would tell us the truth. There is so much confusion out there about who You are. But You make it abundantly clear in Your Word who You are. For some of us, You've made it abundantly clear who You are in our own lives as You've acted upon us, as You've moved upon us, as You've shown the reality of who You are. It's beautiful. Lord, I want to be obedient to You. As You rush on my heart to do something, I want to be able to be obedient. I want to give this opportunity that if anybody wants to say yes, if you've not yet said yes and you just want to say yes and be a Christian and accept the reality of who You are to you personally, I just want you to, by a show of your hand, you can just kind of just pick your hand up and just say, Lord, I want to be a Christian. That's all. I want to be a Christian. I've been told by so many that it's something else. But tonight You spoke to me clearly. That's what my hand up means. You spoke to me clearly, Lord. And I want to be part of Your family. If that's you, and I saw a couple hands go up, I don't know your heart whatsoever, but I rejoice in that. I just want to let you know that if you desire to be baptized, you can. The water's warm and ready for you. God must have known you were coming here tonight. If you want to be baptized, we can go ahead and do that. We got towels. If you just want to pray with someone afterwards or ask questions about Jesus, you can. I'll be up by the front of the house, by the door. I'm going to go behind this wall afterwards. If anyone wants to just spend a little time in prayer about anything, you can go right to my left behind this wall and just hang out there with brothers and sisters in Christ. Pray. You can keep your heads bowed for a moment as I'm going to ask a couple of folks if they would come and pass out this communion. These gentlemen are going to pass out this communion to you now. If you would hold on to it for just a moment, and we're going to take it together as a family. They'll nudge you when the tray comes. Take a few minutes, though, while you're waiting for that to come. Just kind of be thinking about this. The Bible talks us that we're supposed to do this communion to remember Him. And we've been on a pursuit of truth to find out who Jesus Christ is. And So he's told you tonight who he is. But maybe he hasn't been your creator. Maybe he hasn't been your pastor. Maybe he hasn't been your savior. Maybe he hasn't been the senior in your home, priority, possessor of you. So maybe you could take a few moments and kind of work that thing out with him. Just kind of repent. Just let him know, hey, Lord, I'm sorry. I always believed in you, but I didn't realize you were like my pastor. I didn't realize that you were going to speak to me and you were going to pray for me every day. I didn't know that. Today, when you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. If you heard the voice of God through this messenger, I'm nothing, he's everything. If you heard his voice, don't harden your heart. Just do what he's telling you to do. Jesus Christ loves you. He has your best interest at heart. You're part of his family. He's praying for you. He also said he wants his bride to be one with each other. It says he and the Father are one. He wants us to be one. Think about that. It's an honor and a blessing and a privilege to be given the faith to believe. To be given the privilege of being part of his body is a gift. It's a privilege, just that. It's a privilege. And so, Lord, we're very, very thankful for that. For those of us whose life has been invaded with the truth of who you are, and we've been given the opportunity to say yes to you as Lord and Savior of our life, we thank you. All this happened, Lord, when you came here to this earth to reveal who God was to us and to make a way when there was no way. And it happened on the cross, where you willingly laid down your life so that we don't have to. That's awesome. That's awesome. Lord, that's what we celebrate right now. We celebrate this right now with the bread and the cup. We celebrate this amazing love shown to us, that you would lay down your life and die for us while we were still sinners. Amazing. So now, Lord, as a family of faith, for those of us who have trusted you with our eternal life, we just lift up this bread to say, Lord, thank you for your body. Thank you for your sacrifice, Lord. Thank you for laying down your life for us on that cross. We take this bread in remembrance of him. Earlier I said that God is the possessor of all things, and it's his earth, and it's his Florida, it's his heaven. He decides. He also decided, because he's just and perfect, that if the sin has been committed, if there's been a crime, there must be a punishment. And that punishment was death, blood. That's what he asks for. Whether we like it or not, that's what he asks for. That's what he demands. Knowing that there was no way around his perfection and his rule, and he's not a God who will change his mind or lie, he comes down in the flesh, goes to the cross, and sheds his own blood for you. That's why we take the cup. Drink in remembrance of this. What a mighty God we serve. I think I know what they're going to sing. Great is His faithfulness, right? He is so faithful. I just want to know, if God spoke to you tonight in some way, would you raise your hand? Anyone? Anyone? He's faithful, right? You showed up and asked for Him to come. There He is. So faithful. Would you come to your feet, please? We give Him one last opportunity tonight, together, to worship our King. So let's do that. Thank you so much for letting me share His word with you. I love you all very, very much. Not nearly as much as Jesus does. And I'm going to start to pray for you more. That's my commitment to you. All right? I love you all. Thank you.